everybody. We are at the SOSV Revolution Space in San Francisco. I'm Kayla Liederbach, SOSV's marketing manager, and I'm here with Melanie Matheu, who is CEO and co-founder of Prellis Biologics.
Hi, I'm Melanie, yep, CEO and founder of Prellis Bio.
Yeah. So thanks for being here today.
Thank you.
We have the female founder spotlight to give women their due credit in the business world. And of course, to put a spotlight on all the amazing female founders we have on our portfolio. And Prellis, in particular, is such an interesting company that I wanted people to know more about.
So, thank you. Yeah.
So at Prellis, you're 3D printing tissues. Mm-hmm. Can you explain more about that?
Yeah, so human organs and tissues. Believe it or not, I actually had someone say to me once, you're 3D printing tissue paper? Oh. No. That's fine. That
True.
Process is well established. No, so 3D organs and tissues. So transplantable tissues is what we're after. Really solving the organ shortage is our vision. Can we produce organs on demand for people who have catastrophic disease, catastrophic liver failure, or chronic lung failure or kidney disease, and they eventually just run out of options? Can we come in and provide a viable solution and hopefully build it from their own cells so that we don't have organ rejection? And so we have a novel technology that prints at the 1 micron resolution. And so with that, we can get after building the tiny blood vessels and capillaries that make organs and tissues possible. If you start bioprinting at the resolutions of an extrusion printer, about 100 to 50 microns, you really can't get down to the fine physiology that you need to make an organ or tissue work. Mm-hmm. So that's the core of our technology, and it has a lot of applications therein, but really that's the vision of our company, and that's how we do it.
Right, because without the capillaries, right, the blood wouldn't flow in and out, things wouldn't function in the organ.
Yeah, so if you think about it this way, like the surface area to volume ratio of something that's really tiny is about equal, right? Like that's why cells are round, and so that's the best, most efficient way to distribute oxygen to a tissue. It's not through a large blood vessel, it's through a tiny one.
Wow, that's some sci-fi.
Happening
in real life. I mean, 3D printing organs, people who are waiting for transplants, all the people that would save, and also...
That's our mission.
Medical testing, I'm sure, right?
Absolutely. So we have a lot of pre-FDA applications where we can, and we kind of realized this, if you want to talk about pivot points in a business,
right.
It wasn't really a full pivot. It was just on the way to transplanting, building transplantable organs. We had to test our structures and make sure cells would grow on them, make sure that cells would adapt to them and start to differentiate and do what we would expect them to do or start to behave like cells do in 3D tissue. So we were doing some tests in our lab. They were behaving properly. And we thought, well, wait a minute. A lot of people could use this in research. And 3D cell culture really does speed up things like drug development. Cells behave differently in 3D than they do in 2D, mm-hmm. and it allows for really more accurate drug testing. Mm-hmm. And so right now we're working with over 35 labs, academic and industry, and they are testing our cell culture in 3D, everything from liver to, what do we have, liver, vascular cells, tumor cells of 8 or 9 different tumor lines, iPSC differentiation in 3D. Some people are doing alveolar cells on our structures. All these different cell types work quite well. And mm-hmm. a lot of people are doing preclinical testing and drug development work with them.
That's awesome.
Thanks.
So, so when did you become interested in science?
Oh, yeah. This goes way back. And so... someone else asked me a similar question, and I'll go deep. we'll go way back. I think I was interested in science before I knew what science was. I kind of grew up in the countryside. I was a super curious kid. I'd be out in the fields playing. My sister would have her Barbie dolls, and like we'd trade off, like, let's go play in the field. I'll do a Barbie doll show with you. So I was the one who was outside all the time, like, catching things like little bugs or little frogs and being like, what is that? How does that work? And just kind of observing the natural world around me was like just my childhood happy mm-hmm. place. And, as I was exposed to science growing up, I realized that the way I was observing the world already could be codified. You could start to build hypotheses around things. You could ask questions that were really interesting, kind of similar questions I had when I was a kid. How does this work, right? Mm. And that just seemed like a very natural career path for me. It was something I was already drawn to.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
So which women have had the biggest impact on your life and career?
Oh, so many. You know, thinking about growing up, it makes me think of a lot of the early science teachers I had. Mm. And we had some pretty good science teachers. I remember in second grade, we had a Marge de Stabler, and her husband was a Nobel Prize winner. And she was, you know, a PhD scientist in her own right, who had decided to semi-retire and teach children about science. So she had us doing, like, all sorts of crazy chemical extractions in the classroom, like things your parents would have to come in and sit with you to do because the school, like, wouldn't sign off on it.
Wow.
Yeah, she was great. And then I had a great middle school science teacher that really encouraged me to, like, enter competitions with things, and I ended up winning one. And that was kind of, it was a signal to me that this was something I could do and was good at. And that was really kind of set me down the path.
That's cool. And that you could see these other women in science.
Exactly. And they were so confident and so competent in what they knew. And it was just, they were just great role models.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And where did you grow up?
I grew up here in the peninsula in San Francisco.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, so I'm local.
Okay.
Not common.
So what is your career path that led you to starting your own company?
Yeah. So nothing in my career path would indicate really that I was going to start my own company. There were maybe two signals there. And I would say one is that I've always been kind of an ideas person. Like, I can't sit still unless I have like three ideas going at once. And so a lot of them ended up being kind of slightly entrepreneurial ideas. Like, I would solve a problem in my grad school lab and I'm like, why hasn't someone solved this problem for everybody else? Maybe I should file a patent. Like, that would be cool. Like, let's get this out there. Like, that was always kind of in the back of my mind. Mm-hmm. Is like, can we do research better and faster? And can I drive it forward for other people? Because science is a deep, massive field, and there are too many questions out there, and I think we move slowly. The other thing I think was a major influence, I had three professors in a row that I worked for. My PhD advisor, Mike Halen, Bart Lambrecht, who was a postdoc advisor in Belgium, and Jeff Bluestone at UCSF, all three of them were either heads of their departments, and Jeff was an executive vice chancellor. All three of them were very entrepreneurial and very amenable to talking about science and what it could do beyond the lab. And I think that helped influence my career. And they were both scientists and business people, all three of them. And so that made me feel like that could be possible.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So when did you get the idea for Prellis?
Oh, yeah. So Prellis, it goes back to a podcast. I was driving home late from a night at UCSF working and doing some imaging experiments with a two-photon microscope. And I listened to a podcast where they were asking about transplantable human organs. And I always thought that was kind of cool. Mm-hmm. To me, it was kind of sci-fi-y too. Like, I did surgeries, I looked at organs all the time, but I'd never, you know, I was like, oh, that's out there, right? It's a little new. And the question the host asked was really good. He said, okay, great, we've got all these transplantable hearts and ears and skin, really, when are we getting a transplantable organ? And the surgeon who was being interviewed paused for a long time, which made me take note. And he said, probably maybe 20 years, it's out there. And the host says, well, why? You know, we keep having these breakthroughs reported in the media, and I'm sure everyone's seen them. Like, oh, transplantable heart printed or something like that. And the surgeon said, really, we haven't solved this fundamental barrier of building microvasculature and capillaries. And I thought, well, I was just imaging them. I was just looking at them under a microscope. Why can't I build them? And that thought that it was a simple problem, or perhaps not a simple problem, but a well-defined problem standing between all of this good research, all of the stem cell research we've done, and transplantable organs. All we had to do was print those capillaries at scale. I mean, that really stuck
Wow.
with me, right? Like, it's a well-defined problem. I can already see it in my microscope. Why can't I build them? And so that seed of a question stuck with me for actually a couple years. just kind of like rattled around, and I was, gosh, like, why can't I? And I left UCSF to work on another startup project. And when that company closed, I had 4 or 5 months of free time to go look for another job, but I'd gotten a bit of compensation. And I thought, you know, if I don't really try to solve this problem now, when will I? I've got some free time. I'm not like desperate for cash at the moment. And set to it.
Wow.
That's the whole story. Sorry, I can talk if you couldn't tell.
So what is the biotech industry like for women currently?
I think it's actually a pretty good industry mm-hmm. for women. It's hard to be taken seriously sometimes as a woman scientist. People don't usually guess that I'm the physiologist in the room with a PhD in physiology, biophysics, and 15 years of academia behind me. They don't just think that's me, right? But people are starting to understand and I think recognize that about 50%, if not slightly more, PhD graduates are women. Mm-hmm. And so this field is really well balanced between female and male contributions. Perhaps not in the upper echelons of academia yet, but I think we're starting to get there. And when I go to hire and I put a job posting out, my applicants are 50-50 man-woman, and it's really easy to have a balanced company.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's encouraging. It's amazing to hear that that is happening, because I know that in academia it seems to be very balanced, mm-hmm. but there aren't as many, don't seem to be as many women like being CEOs of companies.
Right, right. And I think there are a few driving factors there. Women and not across the board, but if you're going to draw like a Gaussian curve, a lot of women tend to be slightly less high on the risk-taking scale. Mm-hmm. I know I'm low on the risk-taking scale, actually, which sounds weird being a company founder who just set out and did this. I'm very low on the risk-taking scale, and so it is a risky thing to start a business. You know, I didn't take a paycheck for 8 months. I bootstrapped a company, the first patent filings myself. I sold a condo I owned to do it. And so that was, you know, you really put your entire life on the line when you start a company. And, a lot of women kind of, you know, they have a family, they don't really feel like that's something they can do. Mm. I think it's actually less risky than people think, because of the amount you learn and the contacts you make, like you can always, you know, gain from this in a significant way. Another thing too is that I think women aren't taught to be entrepreneurs enough. A little bit they are, but really not encouraged the same way guys are. Mm. Half the time I had an idea, it was like, that's a nice idea. And then I'd watch a male colleague have an idea and it was like, oh, you should totally do this, this, and this with it, and you can just run with it. So I think the advice I got was often different. I think there's just many factors.
Right.
There. Yeah, many small factors that add up.
Right.
Yeah.
To hear you say that it's not as risky as you might think, that's amazing. Yeah. That's why we need more female role models for mm-hmm. other women, hence female founder spotlight.
Yeah.
Okay. So what are some things that you accomplished at SOSV's IndieBio Accelerator?
Oh, gosh, so much. It's really like a boot camp for a startup. It was amazing. I came in kind of thinking I knew what I should do and having a fuzzy idea of how to get a company going and rolling. And, almost every day there were experts here to talk to us, like people encouraging us in different ways and teaching us how to build a business, how to do marketing, how to chat with investors, how to make your idea very succinct and clear so that you are properly communicating all this really difficult science through this filter of how it will work and this is why it will work. Mm-hmm. So I feel like personal learning was achieved here, definitely. We got our first printer working here, which was awesome. So SOSV gave us the funds to put together a free space optical table, get the laser we needed, all the optical components, hire a couple engineers to work on it pretty hard, and we had it. You know, we got the proof of concept in hand here at SOSV IndieBio.
That's a special thing.
it was pretty great. It was one of those days when you like kind of pinch yourself, because it was all on paper before then, and physics and optics, like, they generally work. when you put it on paper. You send a laser beam one way, it does what it should do. And I remember I was like taking a shower in the morning after the first day we got it to work, and I was like, wait, it works. Like, and it works well. Like, it was one of those moments of like, yes. Like, everything I put on paper was real.
Yes. Oh, such a good feeling.
It was a really good feeling, yeah.
So in your opinion, are there any advantages to being a female founder?
Oh yeah, absolutely. It's seen as unique, and so it helps you get in the door. People often are interested to hear what you have to say. There are disadvantages as well that are well documented. Female founders typically raise less money for the same kind of ideas and whatnot. So there's disadvantages and advantages. Mm-hmm. You know, I think it's still unique to be a female founder in the world, and so that's kind of its own special thing. Yeah,
it is.
Yeah,
and just something that I've been noticing. You know, the fact that we have a female founder spotlight, like we won't even need it in the future.
That sounds so great.
We're doing it now because it is a unique thing,
yeah.
You know, and even some people say, why call you a female founder versus
right.
a founder? Because you are a founder, but just in terms of, you know, putting a spotlight on your specific journey
totally.
And the challenges and
yeah.
things like that, I think is really, really good to talk about.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to that day when it's just founder
yeah.
and we have a true level playing field
mm-hmm.
and there are no, like, disadvantages, advantages that are codified that you have to navigate
right.
while you're pitching and things like that.
Right.
I really hope that day comes. Yeah.
Right. And just awareness is key for both men and women. So
totally.
Which leads me to wondering what do you think men can do to support women in business?
Yeah. Gosh. I don't want to say anything trite here. I mean, really, really pay attention to the ideas and what women are saying. Just listen. Just really pay attention. Because I know I have said a sentence and then had it parroted by someone next to me. And when I say it, it doesn't resonate or come across or get acknowledged. And the exact same sentence from someone next to me will be interpreted entirely differently and paid attention to and respected. So, you know, that's a battle. It's a battle that, you know, women have to come in a little stronger and a little louder and a little more look at me and I have something real to say. And it doesn't, I don't think it should have to be that way. I think the men can actually listen and appreciate that women have a good sense of what business can be
mm-hmm.
and a true under, you know, there are plenty of examples throughout history of strong entrepreneurial women and, you know, leveling that playing field makes it better for everyone. Women make better investments overall. We know that, yeah.
Right. I agree with you so much on the listening thing, and I've had that experience as well, and it really hurts, you know. So anything
I've called people out on it before, yeah. too. I'd be like, I just said that.
I hate to do it. Yeah. I hate to do it, but
like,
by the way,
did you all not hear?
You're welcome.
Yeah.
So what advice do you have for women who are just entering the business world?
Yeah. Be prepared. It's a hustle. Like, there was, we had a little office before we came to IndieBio, and there was a poster on the wall that said, hustle harder. And I looked at that every day, Saturday, Sunday, like, and I would be like, hustle harder. That's the only way you're going to make it. You have to strategize. You have to be thinking about your business all the time. You have to really, it becomes, as a founder, it's a very unique situation because it becomes part of your life. It really is what you are doing with your life to get it off the ground, to make it work. And that's the only way you're going to pivot when you need to, solve the hard problems when you need to, and get a business moving. So it is just so much hard work. And be prepared for that.
Yeah.
Be prepared for that psychologically, physically, whatever you need to do. If you really want your business to work, that's you have to be that dedicated to it.
Mm-hmm. Gear up.
You're up.
Get ready.
Exactly.
Well, Melanie, thank you so much for talking to me. It's so great to see
you. Oh, it's so great to see you, too. We always have a good time.
Yes.
So, yeah, happy to be here. Yep.
Then we should do like
a little
toast
to Shauna Sullivan, IndieBio, Arvind Gupta.
Yay.
Thank you, guys. Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you.